Good morning. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. We belong to God. When we feel overwhelmed, God is on our side. When we are afraid, God will keep us safe. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Blessed be the Lord. Let us pray together the prayer that is printed in your bulletin. Caring God, you call us to be the body of Christ, to live in community, to care for one another, to use our different gifts. Instead of working to sustain community, we follow our own desires. Instead of trusting in your care, we think we can do it alone. Forgive our neglect of others. Give us obedient spirits that we may care for one another, depend on your love, and use our gifts for your gospel. Amen. God is on our side, offering words of forgiveness, protecting us from danger. We are a forgiven people, bound together in God's love. We are the body of Christ, forgiven and free.
Good morning, everybody. We have a privilege again today to welcome another of Dr. Tim's longtime friends to our worship service. Must be that Saluda and USC connection. Reverend Jerry Temple is so lucky to be recently retired after a long career of service to the United Methodist Church South Carolina Conference. I heard his sermon at 8:30, and I know you're going to be blessed by his words. All right, seniors, one more time to remind you. Wednesday night, July 26th, from 6 to 9 p.m. in Ward Hall, it's a fun night, and it doesn't require you to register, and you don't have to pay. Well, you do have one piece of admission, and that's a covered dish. So you can bring something to share. It's going to be games and cornhole and door prizes, but most of all, it's going to be a chance to visit and share some laughs. Thanks again for your warm welcome to people around you. I know you fill out the friendship pads, especially if you're new. That's a great help. As you note the various events of the church bulletin and newsletter, know that these are open to all. If you're not yet a member, attending a social gathering or thinking about the upcoming Bible study is often an excellent way to see if St. John's is that perfect fit for you. We will officially welcome new members next month on August 27th when Dr. Tim is here. Meanwhile, if anyone has any questions or is interested in considering becoming a member, please call me. I'm at the church office. Dr. Tim's travels in the Congo have been both demanding and fulfilling. His posts on Facebook hint that we will be blessed with future sermons and blogs which capture the moving experiences of profound faith and fortitude in places of abject poverty. Though he returns and we pray for travel mercies, I think he's left a piece of his heart in the Congo. Next Sunday, he will be back in the States, but he'll be preaching at Lake Junaluska, which means it's a homecoming because he has invited Dr. George Owl to preach to us to all services. I know we're going to love that and pass the word along. Bless you and thank you for filling out those friendship ads and for continuing to be the hospitable place where people feel welcome.
Thank you.
as God's chosen people with zeal, conviction, and hope, let us stand together and declare through the Apostles' Creed what we do believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Let us pray. Gracious and wonderful Father, we thank you for this experience we have to come and to worship you. We thank you for this sacred place, a place where people of all ages and genders and races come, because we know that we are truly one in you. We thank you that you are holy and just and righteous in all of your ways, filled with grace, mercy, and love. All-knowing, all-powerful, and ever-present. We thank you that you are our creator, our provider, our sustainer, and our redeemer. And we pray, Father, that we will live lives that are worthy of your nature and your character. Gracious Jesus, we thank you that you are truly our suffering servant. You are our Savior on the cross. You were our resurrection, our intercessory with the Father. You became poor so that we could become rich. We thank you that through your perfect obedience that we have life and we have it abundantly. We thank you that you do cause us to live and you cause us to live again. And we thank you that you have invited us to spend eternity with you. Holy Spirit, thank you for bringing to us the presence of the Father and the Son. Thank you for convicting us of our sins and leading and guiding us to the truth. Thank you for living within us, giving us strength, giving us words to say when we're confronted with a situation which we seem that our minds and that our thoughts cannot materialize any words to make sense or to stand our ground. Thank you for speaking through us. And gracious God, we thank you for the church, for our mission. We thank you that you've given us the opportunity to not only come and worship you, but to take what we hear and see and take it into the world, because we believe and know that your grace and mercy can make a difference. And I do thank you for this church. I thank you for its many years of history and for the pastors who've served here and served so faithfully. We ask you to be with Tim and protect him and keep him safe as he travels, and that you will fill his heart with words to say to those who are there to listen. We thank you for the choir and the music part of our church. Music is so important in our faith. Songs that teach us theology, songs that speak to our heart. And I pray, Father, that when we leave this place this morning, that in some way that we are different, that we allow every time we come into your presence to make some change, alter something in us that needs to be different. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the prayer that you gave to your disciples, a prayer that is an example of how we should pray. And this morning, in honoring you and your wisdom, we pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
With an abundance of gifts, with the true generosity, let us give ourselves this morning as I invite the ushers to come forward to receive our tithes and our offerings. Our hymn of preparation is found in your little blue pew book, The Faith We Sing, number 2176. And as we sing this hymn through twice, we invite the children from age 3 through 2nd grade to follow the crucifer to the chapel for Children's Church.
good to be with you this morning. I'm not sure I've ever been in this sanctuary this morning, today until this morning. It's a beautiful sanctuary. I know you're very proud of it. And it's good to have been asked by Tim to come and help him out a little bit while he's out of town. I've known Tim for a long time. I guess Tim was 15 or 16 years old when I met him. I told people this morning, I remember Tim when he had hair and it was dark. That's how long I've known him. I would tell you some stories about Tim, but you would probably believe them. That's sad. I was born in the old Aiken County Hospital. Even though we live in the Johnston-Saluda area, when you had to go to the hospital, you either went to Greenwood, and I think in those days you came to Aiken. So my mother came here to Aiken, and I was born in the old hospital. Don't remember much about it, but... But again, I've been surprised. I hadn't been in Aiken in a long time. How much you have grown. Golly, Aiken is really a good-sized city now. It really is. So I know it means a lot to do that for you. I also, you know, I want to say this. In my 37 years of ministry, I could never figure out what to do with my hands. I just don't know where to put them sometimes, you know. That's why sometimes when I'm at Buncombe Street, they had this, anyway, I just stand out in the middle. I knew what to do with them, then I could drop them, you know. But here you're always trying to figure out. But anyway, if you see me trying to figure out what to do with my hands, in 37 years, I have not figured that out yet, and I don't think I'm going to try now. Our scripture reading is taken from Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 11 through 13. Romans 12, 11 through 13. Listen to these words of Paul. Do not lag in zeal. Be enthusiastic in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Endure in suffering. Persist in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Pursue hospitality. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. If you are a sports buff like I am, you're probably familiar with the name Al Michaels. In 1995, he was named the Sportscaster of the Year. In his acceptance speech, he made reference to a simple caution he received very early in his career from an older play-by-play announcer by the name of Kirk Gowdy. Gowdy told him, he said, "Al, you're going to do good. You're a good kid. But I want you to remember this. Don't ever let yourself become gated." Become jaded. The word jaded means to become tired, to become bored, to lose interest in. I think Gowdy was warning Michaels not to let time and the challenges of life rob him of his enthusiasm, his passion for sports. Barna Research Group is an evangelical Christian polling firm. They stated that a vast majority of people who accept Christ as their Savior do so before they reach the age of 18. The International Bible Society tells us that 83% of all Christians make their commitment to Christ between the ages of 4 and 14. And since the average life expectancy in the U.S. is somewhere between 77 and 78 years old, that means a great percentage of us are going to live a long time on this earth as Christians. I accepted Christ as my Savior. I became a Christian about 1 month before my 18th birthday. Of the 66 years that I have lived 48 of those years as a Christian. My father died about 2 years ago at 92. My mother will be 92 this coming September. So I think there's a good chance that I'm going to live into my 90s. If so, when I die, I will have lived over 70 years as a Christian. That's a long time to be a Christian, isn't it? And my hope in prayer is that during this long period of time of being a Christian, is that I don't ever become jaded, that I don't become tired of, bored with, or lose interest in my Christian faith, that I don't ever allow time and the challenges of life to rob me of my enthusiasm or cause my passion for God to fade. I don't ever want that to happen. I had one of those unique conversion experiences. I'm one of those persons can tell you the place, the date, and the approximate time that I asked Christ into my heart. Black Mountain, North Carolina, Fellowship of Christian Athlete Camp. Thursday night, June 6, 1969, somewhere between 9 and 9:30. That night, I experienced the most real, the most authentic thing I've ever experienced in my life, the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And as a new Christian, my initial enthusiasm, passion, and zeal for God was overwhelming and all-consuming. I could not, as a young Christian, get enough of spiritual things. I could not get enough of praying, or going to prayer meetings. I could not get enough of reading my Bible or attending Bible studies. I could not get enough of going to church. I could not get enough of listening to Christian music. I'm one of those persons, I'm at that age where I love the old hymns. I sang them growing up. Also, I started listening to the contemporary Christian music in the early 70s, and I have such a love for it. So I've always, I have satellite radio, and I only put it on one station. I keep thinking, my wife keeps saying, why are you paying all that money and you only listen to one station? It's station 63. They play contemporary Christian music, and I just love it. And I never got too much of sharing my faith and telling people about Jesus. I consider these early years of my faith to be one of the most exciting times of my life. A time that still impacts my life even today. I don't ever want to lose that enthusiasm, that passion, that zeal that I once had. I not only want to sustain it and maintain it, I want to make it grow deeper and stronger. You see, I have learned that God uses our passion, our enthusiasm, and our zeal as a means, a way of motivating us, inspiring us to seek a deeper, more intimate relationship with Him. Enthusiasm and passion and zeal are such a vital part of spiritual growth. An unenthusiastic Christian is going to have very little interest in striving to be a more faithful follower of Jesus Christ. If you, over the years, have allowed yourself to become an unenthusiastic Christian, I would say this morning, you have very little interest in being truly a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, "Nothing great is ever accomplished without enthusiasm." Charles Schwab states, "A person can succeed at almost anything if they have unlimited enthusiasm." Have you ever seen a person who has no enthusiasm, no passion, no zeal for anything? Have you ever seen them accomplish anything great? Not going to happen. People who accomplish great things usually have a passion for what it is. So I think it's so very important that we understand that God desires us to be enthusiastic and passionate about our faith, so that God can do great things in us and through us. Because when we maintain a high level of passion and enthusiasm for God, that also means that we remain open and receptive to God doing something in us, doing something great in our lives. If we maintain our passion and enthusiasm for God, unfortunately, it's all too possible to lose that enthusiasm, that passion that we first experience when we ask Christ into our hearts. The truth is, no matter how intense our enthusiasm, our passion may have been in the past, it can dissipate. It can dry up. It can even disappear. The flame that once burned so bright in our lives can grow extremely dim. So how do we maintain that enthusiasm? How do we maintain that passion, that zeal? How do we stay enthusiastic as a Christian for 20 and 30 and 40 and 50 and 60 and even 70 years? How do we maintain that and not lose it? I've always noticed that there seems to be a connection between one's interest and one's enthusiasm, that one affects the other. If our interest in something lessens, so does our enthusiasm gets less. If there is a decline in interest, there is a decline in enthusiasm. That's why it is so very important that we never lose our interest in God. I think there's truly one important thing that we need to do and need to acknowledge. If we sense that our passion for God is fading, it's not what it used to be, I think we have to acknowledge that the trouble is not at God's end. God has not failed in some way. The trouble is at our end. We have failed. We have dropped the ball. We have allowed this to happen. The problem is, or the problem is not that God has lost interest in us, is that we have allowed our interest in God over the years to diminish. God hasn't pulled back. We have. I want to share with you three things that I think will help us avoid losing our enthusiasm, our passion for God. Three things that can come into play in our lives. First, I believe if we want to avoid losing our passion, our interest in God, we must guard against becoming complacent. Complacency is a feeling of satisfaction with where we are in life. So much so, we no longer see a need to grow, to change, to improve. Complacency makes us so comfortable, we no longer want to be challenged. You know that you've reached a state of complacency when you don't want to be challenged anymore. You don't want your Sunday school teacher, you don't want your minister, or a Christian family member or friend to challenge you about your faith anymore. Complacency makes us too contented to realize that something is missing in our life of faith. We get so contented that we don't we're not aware that something that was once important to us is no longer present in our lives. Complacency is a strange beast. It seems to sneak up on us quite gently. It happens over a long period of time. It almost goes unnoticed. Complacency kind of lulls us to sleep. And then one day we find ourselves just settling for less in life. We're okay with where we are spiritually, wherever it is. And we have no interest or desire to seek a deeper faith. Just not interested in it. Not something that I'm concerned about. The danger with complacency is that it makes us a self-satisfied underachiever when it comes to spiritual things. Have you ever thought about yourself being an underachiever when it comes to spiritual things? That I have underachieved. I'm not who God wants me to be or who I can be in my faith. There is no upside to complacency. There's no advantage or benefits of being complacent. Complacency would much rather have less than more. Would much rather have less than more. Complacency will drain us of our enthusiasm and our passion for God. Because when you settle for less, it's impossible to have more. The second thing we need to do to make sure that we do not lose our passion, our enthusiasm for God, is that we must always remember to keep a safe distance from the world. To keep a safe distance from the world. Now, by world, I don't mean planet Earth and all of its inhabitants. I mean the secular world. The world that stands in opposition to God. That part of society, of culture, which looks at reality from a totally different perspective. One that is void of God's divine truth. It's somewhat of a humanistic perspective. That perspective tells us to live only for the moment. What really matters is the here and now. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you may die. You only go around once in life. All that matters is the here and the now. Usually people who think this way have a tendency to reject all moral absolutes that come from God. It seems that it's their desire to see that everything in life is negotiable. You don't have to accept it as right or wrong, but whatever it is negotiable. And that happiness is found in being set free from all restraints, from all restraints. That's how you find happiness, is freedom from restraints. And the reason we're unhappy is because the world or the church or God has placed all these restraints upon us. And if we can just free ourselves from those restraints, then we'll be okay. We'll be happy. There's no idea of God because God has no place, no purpose. In this way of thinking, God is irrelevant. I think this is the world that James is talking about in his letter in chapter 4, verse 4, when he says, friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God. Friendship with the world that I just described, makes you an enemy with God. In other words, the more we become attached to this world, the more we think and act like this world, the less loyal we're going to be to God. When we compromise our loyalty to God, our enthusiasm and passion for God takes a major hit. It's going to go down. The closer we get to the world, the further away we get from God. And when we're going in the wrong direction, how in the world we ever be able to maintain or sustain that once enthusiasm and passion that we had for God? Remember, I like Jesus' words. He implied that we are to be in the world, but not of the world. There's a lot of things in this world that God wants us to enjoy. But don't become too attached to it. Don't let the world decide how you're going to think and act. Because if you do, if I do, you and I will become less loyal to God. And when we become less loyal to God, our passion for God takes a nosedive. And then, make sure I don't lose time. And then another thing I think that we need to understand, that if we want to avoid losing our passion, our enthusiasm, then we need to accept that adversity is a part of life. That as Christians, we are not exempt from difficult times. We're just not. You may think you can. You may think that you can outsmart, outmaneuver, outrun all the problems of life, but you can't. At some point, it will catch up with you. There are those here this morning may have gone for many years, and all of a sudden, it may be you, it may be your spouse, a sibling, a child is fighting for their life. Your spouse may have told you they don't love you anymore and they don't want to be married to you. You have a teenage child that's out of control and you don't know how to get control of that child. Adversity is a part of life. I like what Peter said in his first letter. He says, those that God love dearly, they should not be surprised when intense suffering comes. Those that God loves dearly, they should not be surprised when intense suffering comes. In other words, what Peter is saying, Christians, when it comes to suffering, when it comes to pain and personal loss, expect it. Expect it. Don't fear it. Don't dread it. Don't try to escape it, but expect it. And by expecting here, I think he means be prepared, be ready for it. Always be read up. Study and know the Word of God and let it become a part of you. Always be prayed up so that when it comes, it will not knock you off your feet and cause you to doubt your faith in God. Nothing like adversity can take the wind out of our sails. Nothing. Nothing can drain us of our energy or alter our mood or color our outlook on life like pain and sorrow and suffering. Nothing can. And if we're not careful, and if we're not ready, and if we're not prepared, then it can deplete our passion and enthusiasm. We have many soldiers today who are training, men and women who are training. They are training for war. And many of those may never be in a war, but they're trained and they're prepared for war. I don't know about you, but I hope and I pray that I'm always in training, preparing myself for what may come down the road, because I have no idea what it might be. I think sometimes we lose our enthusiasm and passion because we were not ready, we were not prepared with what we were hit with. I shared this with you. Back in my little home church, there was a family, the Proctors. They were good people, Mr. and Mrs. Proctor, always with a smile on their face, just a delight. I remember as a small kid enjoying being around them. They were kind of the life of the church. They had a great sense of humor. Their son Wayne was a couple years older than me. Of course, you know, I'm of the generation of Vietnam. So when Wayne graduated from high school, he was drafted into the Army. And after basic training and some further training, he was sent to Vietnam. Being in Vietnam about 5 or 6 months, he steps on a mine and he's just blown up. His body is sent back to the state basically in pieces. This wonderful, loving couple who seemed to be always smiling lost their smile, and they never got it back. Be prepared. Be ready. Don't be surprised by the intense suffering that may come your way. I want to share with you quickly, because I know we're running out of time, how we can maintain that enthusiasm, how we can hold on to that passion, and for that passion, enthusiasm, even to grow deeper and stronger through the years. Paul kind of gives us some ideas of that, of how to keep the fire burning. You know, don't let the fire go out. How to keep the fire burning in our lives. Again, in chapter 12, verse 11, he says, "Do not lag in zeal." Listen, be enthusiastic in spirit. Serve the Lord. That term could best be understood as, when it comes to serving God, be all in. You know, that's Dabo's word up in Clemson. About he asked his players to be all in. If you can't be all in, then go play football somewhere else. And so the word here to serve means to be all in. Devote yourself completely to serving the God. Place yourself at God's disposal. Have a willing heart that wants to serve God seriously, consistently, faithfully, without any reservations, without any excuses, without any strings attached. It's hard to maintain our enthusiasm and our passion for God if we're just going through the motions of being a Christian. If you're not all in, there's a good chance that you and I are just going through the motions. That's all it is. And passion and enthusiasm can only truly exist in a heart that is deeply devoted to God, that is all in. If you're all in, your enthusiasm and passion will sustain itself, will grow and become deeper. The second thing Paul tells us is rejoice in hope. If you want to keep the fire burning, rejoice in hope. That means let your joy be found in your hope. Let your joy be found in your hope. Not in yourself, not in your family, not in your friends, not in your church, not in the things that you have accomplished in life, the things you have achieved, not in the things of this world, but let your joy be found in your hope in Christ, the one who's conquered sin and death and has made it possible that you and I will have a future resurrection to eternal life. The word hope means a firm assurance, a confident expectation that the best is still to come. That the best is still to come. You probably remember that old story of grandmother taking up the plates and the knives and spoons after she'd fed them a wonderful lunch, and her little granddaughter went to give her the fork, and she said, "No, keep the fork, because the best is yet to come." Talking about the dessert. There is something good about having hope in a dessert that is yet to come. Knowing that God has an eternal plan for your life. That you have a future beyond the grave. The joy that we find in our hope is powerful. It really is. It has the power to cause our souls just to shout. It has the power to ignite passion and enthusiasm in our life that will never go out if we find our joy and our hope. You know why sometimes we don't have much joy in our life? It's because it's what we put our hope in. You're putting your hope in something that cannot satisfy. You're putting your hope in something that will never last. It will never last. And then Paul says, if you want to keep the fire burning, endure suffering. And we just kind of alluded to that. Endure means to persevere, to stand firm, stay calm, be courageous. Don't crack under the pressure. Trust in God's strength and not in yours. You see, when we trust in God's strength and not in ours, we have the patience to wait for God to work His will out in this situation without getting angry or mad or upset. I remember, I think it was my second appointment, I had a family in the church. They were kind of marginal Christians. They came to church when it was convenient or when it suited them. Their teenage daughter is killed in a car wreck, and they're so mad and angry at God. Sometimes God's will is not to get involved, and I accept that. I've always said in my life that a miracle is the exception. The norm is almost always God lets things run their course. And I believe in miracles. I do. I believe that sometimes God intervenes in His wisdom and in His knowledge. But I believe most of the time God lets things run their course. And there is God giving us strength and courage and the ability to face whatever it is. And we face it with faith. And that's a different kind of person when you face something with faith. Then be persistent in prayer. Oh, let me see where I am. Getting close. Be persistent in prayer. That is, in your Christian life, don't go through long periods of time without praying. Don't go for days and weeks and months and years and never offer a prayer to God. If you want to hold on to your passion for God, always be prayed up. You know, I'd like to think that the first things I think about in the morning are eternal things. And some of the last things I think about before I go to sleep is my walk and my faith with God. I want to talk to God all day long. You see, prayer is a wonderful thing. It keeps us focused. It keeps our eyes on God. It helps us stay connected. Now, you can stay connected to a person you never see if you talk to them. Or you can also be disconnected to a person you see if you don't talk to them. Talking to God keeps us connected. And talking to God keeps us humble because it helps us see how small we are and how awesome and great and powerful God is. And when you have an awesome and powerful and strong and mighty God, you've got a passion in your heart, an enthusiasm in your heart for God. And then lastly, contribute to the needs of the saints. Pursue hospitality if you want to keep the fire burning. Share what you have with others. Help those who are in need. Be a difference maker in their life. Be there for those who have no one to turn to. I've always been kind of amazed that when our youth would return from Salkehatchee camp, how enthused and passionate they were. You know why they were? Because they'd been out helping somebody. Somebody who was less fortunate. Somebody who didn't have a whole lot. Or men and women who come back from a mission trip, either local or abroad. And they've gone to someone's home, and maybe their home is almost unlivable. And they go there and they work and they sweat and they see the joy on this person's face when their home is being reestablished and rebuilt, and it revigorates their passion and their enthusiasm and their zeal. And they come back home to the church and they want to do more. If you want more enthusiasm, more passion in your life, go out and make a difference in somebody else's life who has no one to turn to. This morning, I jokingly told him at the first service that I decided to work up a new sermon for this morning. Being retired, it's nice to just have weeks to work on one. I told him I wasn't sure how long it was going to last. I think it could be short, but it could be long. You know how we preachers are. But my thing is this morning, church, as individual Christians, we've got to become more enthused with who we are in Christ. We've got to have a greater passion for the Lord we serve. And church, we have got to be more excited. We need more enthusiasm in our pews. I don't know whether you know it or not, but at one point in Methodist history, we were known as the Shouting Methodists. The only shouting I've ever heard in the Methodist church is in committee meeting rooms. I've heard very little shouting in the sanctuary. That meant that at one point in our history, we were very vocal when we worship. There was a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of passion involved in our worship. I worship most Sundays now at Covenant United Methodist Church in Greenville. And I go to the 9:45 service. It's their contemporary service. And one of the ladies in their band that sings, she just blesses my heart, because a lot of people who get up and sing, they're just singing. But when she's singing, she's worshiping. And it just engages me in worship when I see her do that. You'd be surprised what happens to worship when we come here excited, enthused, and passionate about our faith. May I ask you a question, and then I will close with a hymn. Have you noticed that your passion for God has been fading? It's not what it used to be. Nor is it what it can be. Rediscover that excitement that was probably a part of your life many, many years ago when you gave your heart to Christ. Do I announce the final hymn, or do you do that? I do that, okay. I'm going to ask that we stand and sing our final hymn, number 577, God of Grace and God of Glory. Thank you. Again, I enjoyed being with you this morning. I know it went a little over, so I want you to tell George he's got to take about 5 or 6 minutes off of his sermon because of me going over. Okay, that'll balance it out, I think. What we're deeply interested in, we're also very enthused about. Have a deep interest in God, and your passion, enthusiasm for God will be great. It will be awesome. Go now from this place. Go now in the peace and grace and mercy of God. And share with your fellow people the love of God and the hope we all have in Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.